Hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen. Just by way of coincidence, this particular clip that Sister Timothy shared with us of Pastor Phipps singing, that concert took place at Carnegie Hall in New York City. And just by incident, I was there that night when he rendered that number. You're not able to see myself and my wife in the audience as they were panning across the audience because we were way in the back. But before the meeting started, I did something. I guess it was mischievous. I went down to the front as they were assembling, and I didn't talk to Pastor Phipps, but I talked to Jesse Dixon, who was also there that night, and I sort of played a little trick on him. I acted as if I had known him for a long time, and you know, I'm saying, "Oh, Jesse, how are you? You know, so good to see you again. It's been some time." And I could see he was trying to remember who is this and where did I meet him. But he was being very polite, and I just kept getting more and more excited about seeing him, and said, "It's good to see you here." And you know, but when I said it's good to see you again, the only place I had actually seen him was at home. In one of our CDs, because you know, we listened to him quite a bit. But that particular night was really it was really a grand night, and I think because Pastor Phipps was there that night, there was a large audience of Adventists that were there from all over the city, and we just happened to be among that number. But praise God, we look forward to that day when we will all be able to say hallelujah, hallelujah, amen, as we are welcomed into God's kingdom. That having been said, just want to share a word from the Lord with you at this time. Our scripture reading was taken from Matthew the 25th chapter, and I will just read a portion of that scripture to you as I introduce my sermon title for this day. It says, starting with verse 25, this whole incident actually starts with verse 14, but for the sake of time, it says, then he which had received the one talent came and said, "Lord, I knew thee that thou art a hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown, and gathering where thou hast not strawed. And I was afraid, and I hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, there thou hast that is thine." My message is entitled, "The Call to Manage." The Call to Manage. Let us pray. Gracious Father in heaven, we thank you, dear Lord, that you have brought us to this place of worship. Even though it's virtual, nevertheless, you are in our midst. You are in each and every home, for you are omnipresent. And so we thank you, dear Lord, for tabernacling with us. And we pray to the Lord that you would speak to our hearts and encourage us today as we consider the call to manage and the work to be done. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. The call to manage. I want to put the scene of this particular parable in the proper context. And so we're going to go back a couple of chapters as we meditate upon this scripture. I'm going to go back as far as chapter 23, so we can get an idea of what is actually taking place. In chapter 23 of Matthew, you recall that Jesus had denounced the scribes and the Pharisees, and that he had also lamented over Jerusalem because he saw what was coming. In chapter 24 through 25, he deals with last day events. He deals with end time prophecies. He had carried out his 3.5 years ministries to this point, where he is now preparing to fulfill the mission for which he had come. And so now he is talking seriously about last day events in times. So in Matthew, the 24th chapter, he prophesizes about the persecutions that are to come. You remember in the 24th chapter, he goes out of Jerusalem and he sits upon the hillside, the Mount of Olives, and Ellen White gives us a beautiful description of what happens there, inasmuch that he says he sits there and he looks at Jerusalem, a paradigm of beauty, and he weeps. He weeps over Jerusalem, and he's weeping because of all of the opportunities that God had given to his people. God had sent prophets to them to instruct them and encourage them to follow in the ways of God, and those that God had sent, they were beaten, they were killed, and he just said, oh, if you had only listened, you know, I would have gathered you, you know, as like a mother hen gathers her chicks together to protect them. I watched one nature picture where a mother hen had her brood of little chicks following her, and out in the wilderness, and watching her as she was walking along with her chicks was an eagle. And this eagle was watching, and finally this eagle decided that food was served. And this eagle, went down to grab one of those, and mother hen somehow heard that eagle coming, and she pushed those chicks into a cleft of a rock, as it were. And she stood at the entrance, and that eagle came. She fought that eagle, and she actually successfully fought that eagle off, which is something that doesn't ordinarily happen. But she fought that eagle off, and she protected her chicks. And Christ sitting on that mount, and he was overlooking the city, and he says, "How often I would have gathered you, just like the mother hen gathers her chicks to protect them, but you would not have it." And so he was weeping. He was weeping for his people because he was coming down to the end of his journey. And I believe because he saw that the sacrifice that he was about to make for mankind would be accepted, but not by all. And so he was weeping for his people as he was able to envision what would become of them. Christ's Matthew 23 and in Matthew 25, inclusive of Matthew 25, he includes several parables that emphasizes the importance of preparation for his return. He was going to make this sacrifice, and even though the spirit was willing but the flesh was weak, nevertheless he had set his mind on Calvary, and he was determined that he was going to go through with the mission for which he had come to serve mankind. The faithful and the unfaithful servant in Matthew 24, he spoke about, and how important it was for the servants to be in readiness when the master would arrive in that particular parable. Then there was a parable, he spoke of the parable in Matthew 25 of the wise and the foolish virgins. And in that particular parable, he is again emphasizing how important readiness is, and how careful we have to be in preparing for the coming of the bridegroom, he being the bridegroom. And so Christ has his eyes set. He has his eyes set on Calvary and the conclusion of his work here on earth. And so when we come to Matthew, the 25th chapter, and verses 14 through 30, he is talking about the importance of faithful stewardship or management over that which the master in this parable had placed upon his stewards. Now, we have to understand that this parable is talking about the master being God himself, and the stewards being God's people, and how important it is for us to get into a mindset of what is about to come upon this earth. And the signs of the times are all telling us that that day is soon upon us. And that's what we have been emphasizing in last day events. That's what we have been emphasizing in the prophecies of Daniel and Revelation, that we are, my friends, saints of the Most High, we are living in that time period, and how important it is for us when Christ returns and we will see him face to face, how important it is that we will not be among that number that will be running to the rocks and the mountains and crying out, fall on us, and hide us from his face, but that we want to hear from his lips, when Christ returns, we want to hear from his lips, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Lord. Now we can replace that. We can replace the word servant with steward. We can replace the word servant with manager. Well done, good and faithful steward. Well done, good and faithful manager. Enter into the joy of your Lord. And so today, for the next few minutes, I want to talk to you about the call to be a manager. I want to talk to you, to us, about the call to be stewards of the Most High God. I want to talk to you about the lifestyle of the biblical steward as we compare it with the requirement of the last day steward. Now, biblically, a steward starting from the book of Genesis, when mankind came forth from the hands of his creator. The Bible acknowledges to us that God is the owner of everything. God owned everything in Adam and Eve's life. And that same God who never changes owns everything in our life. And that we are required to turn and manage as best as we can all that he has entrusted to us. Stewards are managers. The goal of a steward is to multiply. Excuse me. The goal of a steward is to multiply that which God has entrusted to us, particularly in as much that sin has entered into the world. We are to multiply the resources that God has entrusted into us for the building up of his kingdom. That means that as stewards, we must be diligent workers. We must be individuals who are faithful to God and who not reluctantly, but eagerly give to God the best of our being. We must eagerly give to God what he has given to us to carry out his work on earth. Bible says that that God loves not a reluctant giver, but that God loves a cheerful giver, one who is giving from the heart because of the relationship that that individual, that steward has with his God. In Matthew, the 28th chapter, just three chapters over from Matthew, the 25th chapter, Christ, after his successful campaign over the devil, because the devil was not able to get Christ to sin, and the devil tried all the way to Calvary, the devil tried to get him to slip up just once, but he was not able to do it. In the book of Hebrews, we're told that Christ was in all points tried. Christ was in all points tempted as we are today. So whatever temptations we are confronted with today, take comfort in knowing that Christ was confronted with it and Christ realized victory over it. He yielded not to temptation in any form or fashion, as amazing as it may be, as I've said before, that he was not even able to get Christ to sin in thought. That's powerful. And so in Matthew, the 28th chapter, he comes forth victorious. He comes forth from the tomb victoriously. And in verses 19 through 20, he gives what constitutes to be a major responsibility of stewardship to his followers. To go into all the world and to teach and to baptize those who would believe in the gospel of his ministry. It was possible. And the one thing that he emphasizes in that commission was that all power in heaven and earth was delivered unto him. And on the basis of that, he says, therefore go. In other words, he was letting his disciples know that whatever tools they needed, whatever talents they had to depend upon, whatever finances that they would stand in need of, that he was making himself responsible to supply those needs according to his riches in glory. That was the great responsibility that was being placed upon his followers. We today are his followers. We today have been called and given the responsibility of this stewardship, this management of the work that Christ has given to us for the finishing of the salvation of mankind. And so we can not be lax in terms of the position that we hold. We are stewards of the Most High God. And let us remember that a steward is like a manager in any business. I think of Walmart, where there are managers in Walmart. I think of Publix, where there are managers in Publix, and we can go on and on and on down the list. That's what stewards are. Stewards are like a local manager who carries out the aims of the owner, not the aims of the steward, but the agenda of the owner. A steward is one who seeks to maximize the profits of the business, not for himself, but for the owner. He seeks to do that while handling all of the day-to-day operations of the business and handling all the problems that are incurred. I well remember a true story that took place in, I think it was in McDonald's or Burger King or one of the other fast food operations. And this object lesson was entitled, "Who Owns Your French Fries?" Who owns your French fries? And it's a story of a man who goes into, well, let's say a McDonald's. He goes into McDonald's and he buys his little boy who was with him. He buys his little boy some French fries. And then the father does what all fathers do. And I know that I'm guilty of it too. He reaches over and he takes one French fry from his son to taste the fries. And the father thinks that his son wouldn't mind. But as he reaches over to take the French fries, the little boy slaps his father's hand and he says, "Don't touch my French fries." So the father thinks, he says, "I didn't realize this before, but my little boy is selfish. And the father says in his mind, as he's looking there at his little boy, as he is busy eating his French fries, the father says to himself, "Doesn't he know? Don't he know who bought the fries? And who those fries actually belong to?" He did not come into McDonald's with anything monetarily. He did not pay for these fries. Rightfully, I own these fries. Rightfully, I own his sneakers. Rightfully, I own the pants that he's wearing. Rightfully, I own the shirt that he has on. Rightfully, I own everything he has. And he is denying me access to one fry. You see, the father knew that his son belonged to him. The father could have gotten angry and decided, "You know what? I'll never buy this little selfish rascal another fry again," just to teach him a lesson. Well, the father could have taken the whole bag of fries and says, "Go get your own, which the little boy would not have been able to do because he had nothing. He brought nothing into McDonald's. And so the father, is saying, why is my son, my little boy, why is he selfish? I've given him a whole package of French fries and I just wanted one fry. And we look at that little boy and we said that we say that that little boy should have realized where his source of blessings lied. But likewise, I want to say to us today, my friends, we must remember what God has given to us. Many of the resources, the many resources that God has given to us do not belong to us. They belong to Him. And we must remember that when God asks for a portion of those resources that He has entrusted to us, when we refuse to share with God that which is His, we are figuratively slapping His hand in a way and saying, keep your hands off of my resources. Keep your hands off of my money. Keep your hands on that which I own. But let us remember the truth is this. Like the little boy brought nothing into McDonald's, we brought nothing into the world. The truth is that God owns it all. And what is it that God expects of us, other than the fact that He wants us to manage what we have, not for our glory, but for His glory and His work? We need to understand that God expects for us to manage not only our monies, but God expects for us to manage our time. God expects for us to manage our God-given talents, not selfishly to build up ourselves, but God expects for us to manage our God-given talents for the building up of His kingdom, for the sharing of His gospel. God expects for us to return dividends on what He has invested in us. To give back a portion of what He has shared with us is what God expects of us. And so stewardship is rooted in the understanding that God owns everything in our lives, including each one of us. And the fact that God owns it all is revealed through several texts of scriptures in the Bible, just by way of example. And in Matthew, the 24th chapter, in the first verse, says that the earth is the Lord's, and everything in it, the world, and all who live in it belongs to God. And so I guess that includes me, and that includes you. In Leviticus, the 25th chapter, verse 23, it is recorded that the land, God says, the land is mine, and you are but aliens and my tenants. We don't own it. God owns it. In Haggai, the second chapter and the 8th verse, we are reminded by God that the silver is mine, the gold is mine, declares the Lord Almighty. And if that was not enough, in 1 Corinthians, the 6th chapter, verses 19 through 20, we are reminded, you are not your own. You were purchased at a price. And the price of our purchase, the price of our redemption was the blood of Jesus Christ himself. And so when we as Christians understand this truth, it should change the way in which we live. It should change the way in which we work. It should change the way in which we spend our time, and also the way in which we spend our money, along with the use of the talents that God has given us. One Randy Barton states that stewardship builds the bridge in our Christian lives. It builds that bridge that will enable us to reconcile our faith and our living in a secular world. When we understand what biblical stewardship is, then we will understand the importance of how we should live our lives every day. Being a steward of God should impact our work. It should impact our lifestyle. It should impact our time. It should impact our family, our finances, our priorities, and everything about our days. And so in our parable of the talents, we're told about a man who went into a far country, but before leaving, he called three of his stewards, three of his managers, and he gave to each one a level of talents. And it was based on their ability to manage. God gives to us on the ability of our abilities to manage what he entrusts to us. Sometimes we feel that we have not been blessed by God. Why did God give someone else more than he has given to me? But let us remember this, that God knows us better than we know ourselves. And God gives us in proportion to what he knows our abilities are. In fact, we're told in scripture that he will not place upon us more than we can bear. That includes management. God will not place upon us more than what we are able to manage. This is so true when it comes to individuals that say, you know, if I could just have more, I could do so much better. And so if you look at individuals who have won the lotteries and they have come into great wealth, you know, especially these mega lottery wins that cover a cross-section of states, where individuals win $600, $700, $800 million. Stories abound of these individuals who won these millions of dollars, who are within 2 or 3 years or less, are penniless. Because although they won all of this money, they did not have the acumen, they did not have the managerial skills to manage it. And so God in his mercy does not place upon us more than we can bear, but God gives us what we can handle. He gives us what we are able to handle, and based on what he gives us, God knows that based on our personality, our skills, our acumen, that we are able to return of that which he provides us with. We are capable of returning 100% on that. And with God, he's satisfied. He is satisfied with the returns because he has not given you more than you are capable of managing. It says that the one that he gave five to, when he had to give an account, he reported back to the master, "You gave me five, and here's another five." That was 100% return. What investor would not be excited about 100% return? Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Well done, well done. The one that received less, he didn't get five, he got two. He says, you gave me two, and here's yet another two. That was 100% return. I'm so glad that God deals with percentages. When it comes to our tithe, God deals with percentages. I don't have to be responsible to God for returning the same amount in tithes as Warren Buffett, who is a billionaire, because I don't have billions. And so God does not require that of me. But he requires 10%. How much fairer can that be? So if I only have 100, God only requires 10% of that in tithe back to him. Far less than Warren Buffett, because he has so much more. And so God is fair. He uses percentages. And so for the one that returned another five, that was 100%. Well done. For the one that had the two talents, he returned another two. Well done. But the one that received the one talent felt that he had been deprived, that God had not favored him in the same way that he had favored the others. Oh, if he had just given me more. But he was stingy with me. And sometimes we can feel that way, that God has been stingy with me, because I have not been blessed to have the same amount as others have. But in essence, God has given all of us the same amount based on our ability to manage. And so the parable tells us that we only held responsible for that which God has seen fit to give us. But in the end, we will be held responsible for how we made use of what he has gifted us. The one that received the one talent, he tried to put the blame on the master for not giving him more. Call the master selfish and hard. And so I didn't utilize the one that you gave me. I didn't utilize it. And what was the master's response? He called him lazy, slothful, wicked, wicked. Now I want to put this in the perspective that we talked about when we started. And I said that Christ at this juncture in his ministry, he's talking about the culmination of the work that he came to do. He's finishing up. He's finishing up his work. And he was not willing that any soul should perish. Let us always remember that the Great Commission, Christ's death was not about profiting from God's resources for ourselves, not being selfish, as we learned in the Sabbath School presentation this morning. Not being selfish, but being willing to share with others, realizing that we are our brothers and sisters' keeper. That God has given what God has given to us, that rather it is a large amount, a small amount, or whatever it is in monetary resources, in talents and gifts, everything that God has given to us, it is for the ushering in and the building up of his kingdom. No more and no less. That is what is priority with God at this point in time. That is why we find God being so preoccupied with salvation throughout the scriptures, the old as well as the new. Because the salvation of mankind is the most important thing to God. Saving mankind is the most important thing to God right now because of the price that was paid to make it possible. And so you'll notice that the one that had the one talent, who thought that it didn't mean much, it was less than everyone else's, than the other two, and so he did nothing with it, he was called wicked. God called him wicked. Because he could have taken that and he could have used it to introduce another soul, putting it into the concept of salvation. It could have been used to enlighten another soul for the kingdom of God. What God has given to us, he holds us responsible for these gifts. We are to use these gifts, not to tear down our barns and build bigger barns for ourselves, but we are to use these gifts for the upbuilding of his kingdom. And if we fail to do any less than that, and we're using these things for our own advancement, then God declares us to be slothful, lazy, and wicked. Wicked. And that wicked is a hard term to use against anyone. But that's how intense God feels about souls that are lost, and individuals who didn't cry out and spare not and use those talents that God has given us for the building up of his kingdom. And so like that servant was called to give an account, let us remember this. Apostle Paul says, the time is coming when every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess. Tongue is going to confess. We're going to have to give an account of our time and how we spent it. We're going to have to give an account to the master. We're going to have to give an account to God for how we spent our time and our monies. We will have to give an account to God for how we use our spiritual gifts and talents for his kingdom. We will have to give an account of how we use the spiritual blessings from God in our lives. We will have to give an account of how we use the resources that God has entrusted to us for his kingdom. We will have to give an account of how we used his monies, because God owns it all. We will have to give an account of how we use his monies for the building up of his kingdom. We'll have to give an account basically on what our lifestyle has been and how our lives did or did not impact the world, and how it did or did not impact for the glory of God. And so we have to take serious this position that we have, my friends, as stewards. We are to work for God's kingdom. And we are to work for the ushering in of that soon coming kingdom. 1 Corinthians the 10th chapter and the 31st verse, as I bring this message to a close, Apostle Paul encourages us. Apostle Paul says, so whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, whatever you do, we're to do it all to the glory and to the honor of God. Our life's work, our careers, cannot be the fulfillment for our lives. It can only be a means to achieve our true purpose. What is our true purpose? We were created for the glory of God. So our work cannot be the end to itself, what we accomplish, but instead only a means to the end. And what is the ultimate end for our lives? The ultimate end for our lives is to be saved in God's soon coming kingdom. That's the work that we have been called to do. Someone has estimated that the average member of a church in their lifetime hears 6,000 sermons. Average member of a church hear over 8,000 songs. And that the average member of a church leads zero people to Christ. And here's a way that this individual broke it down. I thought it was interesting, and I just want to share this with you as I close. Here's the way the problem stacks up in a church with 200 members. This writer says, out of that 200 members, 20 are too old to work. So that leaves 180 left to work. But of the rest, 18 are too timid to accept responsibility. So that leaves 162 left to work. But of that 162, 12 are out of town or away for school. So that leaves 150 to work. But 25 of those work long hours, 6 or 7 days a week. So that leaves 125 left to work. But 20 of those 125 that are left to work are tied down with children. So that leaves 105 left to work. But of that 105 left to work, 20 of those are unable to work because of poor health. So now we're down to 85 left to work. But 55 of the 85 that are left to work are unfaithful. They do not attend church regularly or don't care to attend. So that leaves 30 left to work. Remember, we started with 200 in the church. But 20 of those will attend church but refuse to work. That leaves us with 10 left to work. 8 of those 10 are very tired of doing all the work, and they have asked to be relieved. So that leaves 2 people. That leaves you and the other individual that you're thinking about. But that other individual is too busy doing other things. So that leaves only you. It's an amazing analogy, but unfortunately, to a very large extent, it is so true of many of God's churches. Let me just encourage us today that when we do what God blesses us to do, God enables us to do more. In this parable of the talents, we're told that God gives us all talents, and we need to put those talents to work for Him. There's not one individual here today that has not been blessed by God with at least one talent. And I just want to encourage you by way of this parable today, that you take that talent, that one talent that you have, and I'm sure you have more, and use it all to the glory and honor of God. Ask God today to fill your cup. Fill your cup so that He can use you for the building up of His kingdom. And what I have learned in my own life and in the lives of others, that as you take that gift, that talent that God has given you, that resource that God has blessed you to have, that God will bless you with even more. Just as he took from the one talented individual who didn't invest wisely the talents that He had given him. He didn't invest it into the building up of his kingdom. He took it and He gave it to the other that was able to produce. God will do the same. God will do the same with you. As we invest these talents that God has entrusted to us, as we invest these talents in His work, God will take that faithfulness. God will say, inasmuch that you were faithful and wise in utilizing what He has entrusted to you, that He will give to you even more. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. That is what I want to hear. That is what I want to hear from my Master. How about you? Today, dear Lord, fill my cup. Fill it up. Fill it up. Feed me till I want no more. Our appeal song.
Like the woman at the well, I was seeking for things that would not satisfy. Then I heard my Savior calling, draw from the well that never. Lord, yes,
I lift it up.
Let us say amen. Amen. May the Lord find it convenient to be able to fill our cups with more and more and more for the building up of his kingdom. When I see him one day face to face, I want him to be able to say, as we look at this scripture in Matthew, the 25th chapter, verse 23, says, "The Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things." The one that received the five talents, one that received the five talents, God considered that to be a few things. Whereas the one that received the one talent felt that the one that received the five was far much greater than what he had received. But God says to the one that had received the five, "Thou hast been faithful over a few things." Let us remember that what we have in life, whatever God has entrusted to us in life, let us not make gods out of those things, because they are a few things. In God's universe, they are a few things. Says, "Thou hast been faithful over a few things, I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord." I will make thee ruler over many things. May we be blessed to hear these words from the lips of our Master. Well done. Well done today. Let us pray. Gracious Father in heaven, thank you, dear Lord, for the gift of management. Thank you for the gift of stewardship. Today, we're just asking, dear Lord, that you would just help us to be faithful in our administration of the resources that you have provided for us. Help us to always remember that the talents that we have are not ours. They are resources that you have provided for the building up of your kingdom. Doesn't matter how many we have or how few we feel we have. The number is not significant. It's the work that is put forth in the use of them. Thank you for being so generous, even with the one. And bless us, dear Lord. Bless us to seek not those things that are temporal, but those things that are eternal. And as we leave forth today from this service, may we leave with a new determination to do no more and no less than our very best with that which has been entrusted to us, so that one day we might hear from your lips, "Well done, well done, well done." In Jesus' name, do pray. Amen.